What's going on, guys? It's Mike here with another video, and this will be the beginning of the Halloween franchise review series. We are going to be starting off with the classic Halloween to kick off the series. Now, it turns out that in my Blu-ray collection, they don't have the TV cut, but they do have scenes from the TV cut, which is just fucking awesome. These three scenes, were awesome. I'm just saying that now. And we'll get into them as we proceed with this review. Now, for those of you that have never seen the Halloween movies, don't worry, I will not spoil this. But I do highly advise you go watch it, especially the Halloween season. And don't worry, you're probably not going to have to pay any money to rent them or anything. To rent them or buy the Blu-ray or DVD, whatever the fuck. I prefer to watch on, hell, VHS. You could either maybe find it on YouTube if you're lucky, or an illegal stream site, or if you have cable, you could just watch it on AMC. Around late October, because they just love to do that. And quite frankly, all power to them. Because Halloween, fucking awesome. But enough of me praising it. Now let's actually review it. So the movie starts off where we have a scene with a young child. His name, we figure out, is Michael Myers. You see him coming from, like, across the street, or, like, the front yard. Honestly, it's a little difficult to tell, but I'm pretty sure it's the front yard. Not across the street, what the fuck was I thinking? He's 6 years old when this happens. So, you see him, he's kind of, like, peering into the living room where, his sister is, and her boyfriend. And they're making out, eventually leading to, the sex. But we don't actually get to see them banging. Not that we need to, because we're not watching a porno. Alright, we're getting off topic. So, you see them, they're making out, yada yada yada. They go up the stairs, and you know, they, let's just say this, the boyfriend slays some poon. And, you know, Michael's creeping in the house. He gets a butcher knife or a steak knife out of, like, the kitchen, where out of the knife drawer. Little other utensils in it. And he's, you know, peering around the house, waiting for the boyfriend to leave. You know, putting his shirt back on, yada yada yada, after he just got some. And he peers up the stairs, walks into his room, and grabs his clown mask. Then goes right into his sister's room, and she's in her panties, and she's topless. This is, like, the only nudity we get in this entire movie. We get to see some tits. And not even a good shot of them. So, he walks in the room, and he just stabs the shit out of her, right then and there. Then he walks outside, and his parents come home from a Halloween party. And then, if you watch the TV scenes, it shows his psychologist, who he is obviously assigned to because he fucking killed somebody. And he's in a mental hospital now. Dr. Sam Loomis. Now, if you watch the actual version, this is not in it. If you, by any chance, see this is definitely on YouTube, this clip. I confirm that. In the board meeting talking about, you know, his treatment, he's basically saying this is the most dangerous patient I've ever seen. He's pure evil, blah, 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 blah. Giving his whole spiel. And, you know, they say no. But then it pans forward to the night before Halloween, 1978, when the movie takes place. 15 years after the 6-year-old Michael Myers killed his sister. And you just see mental patients wandering around the yards of the mental hospital. And then Mike just fucking pops out of nowhere and jacks the car, because they were going to transport him to his his trial, because they're going to try him as an adult to determine if he's going to stay in a mental institution or prison, or he's going to go skip around free. And he jacked the car, and he went back to his hometown of Haddonfield. Now, another TV scene. This is right after Michael was stalking this girl named Lori. Like, after the first sort of kind of encounter. You see his doctor in the mental institution kind of looking around at everything. And he goes into his room, and it's a fucking mess. This is a TV scene. If you're lucky enough to see this, you could definitely see this on the 35th anniversary Blu-ray. I can't find it anywhere else. But, you just see his room's just fucking wrecked. And he carves or scribbles or something, sister, on the wall, pertaining to that he is going back to kind of relive killing his sister. Because he's fucking evil, crazy, whatever. So he's got to go back, do what he's got to do. I mean, in all honesty, he doesn't need to, but it's just what he wants to do. So after probably about an entire day of, like, stalking this girl named Lori and her friends, and Dr. Loom is going back to his old childhood home and working with the police to try and find him. Like, you know, and obviously some clues that he was there, like Judith's gravestone missing, as well as a dead dog that's been eaten, and a hardware store that's been broken into with knives and the mask stolen. They eventually lead to the murders. Now this all starts off with, I don't remember all the names. I heard. I'm pretty sure it was Annie. It was Lori Annie. There's one more. But we see him murder one of her friends by choking her out with a phone cord right after she just got done getting it on. Actually, no. That's the second pair of titties we see. We only see two pairs of tits. Actually, no, that wasn't even the first murder. The first murder was Annie getting into her car to go help babysit, and she's stabbed because Mike's hiding in the car like a beast. The second murder is when the other chick, I should really look up my names before I do this shit, is in the bed right after getting it on. She's about to go make a phone call, and Mike, dressed up as a ghost, right after killing her boyfriend, stabbing him on the wall and everything, chokes her out with the phone cord. And then this eventually leads to Lori, we can't get in contact with her friends, and like all good friends do, they go see what's up, finds them all dead, finds the Judith Myers gravestone, and eventually Mike does the famous cut the sleeve of her shirt, trying to stab her. And then all shit breaks loose from there, cat and mouse. Some actually decent self-defense, like the poking in the eye with the clothesline and shit like that. And she actually got a couple decent hits on him, I'm not gonna lie. But you know, every time he would go down, he would just get up, rather be getting stabbed in the eye, or stabbed with his knife, or whatever. He just would not stay down, as Michael Myers had become famous for. So eventually, after all this cat and mouse and dilly dallying and people getting injured, Lori's in another room. This is right after he gets stabbed with his own knife. And he just sits up, kind of like Undertaker style. And He doesn't run. He walks in there because he just doesn't fucking run. He walks on in there. Troy's attempting to strangle her. She actually rips his mask off. Not like rips it, but like takes it off. And you see his face, and turns out he's a human being. Which is pretty fucking freaky, knowing that an average-sized human being could do all this. In a fell swoop. And as he's putting the mask back on, this is Dr. Loomis rushing up the stairs, shoots him once with his gun. Now he walks back in the room, he's just standing there like, bruh, you wanna go? You wanna go? So then Dr. Loomis shoots him twice, and, you know, right off the balcony of the house. And he's laying down there, right on the ground. And Laura's all like, ooh, was that the boogeyman? Because that was a huge thing in this movie, that he was the boogeyman. Like, he wasn't referred to as Michael Myers, except from his psychologist. Because nobody else really knew who the hell he was and why he was doing what he was doing. So, he says, as a matter of fact, I think it was. By the way, Dr. Loomis, Donald Pleasance, fucking phenomenal actor. Throughout all the ones he was in. He's my second favorite actor of all time. My first is John Travolta. But, acting-wise, Donald Pleasance is probably one of the best. Ever. But getting back to how Donald Pleasant said there's no way to stop him, he's evil, he's pure evil, he's not really a man. He looks outside the window to observe Michael laying on the ground after getting shot off the balcony with 6 bullets, and he's gone. He booked it out of there, and then the creepy Halloween music starts playing in the background, which, by the way, makes him... the movie that much creepier. Besides the suspense, the music just makes the suspense even worse, and you are legit screaming, Jesus fucking Christ, I hope they survive this. And he's standing there, he doesn't scream, oh my god, which was an idea that they pitched, like a normal person would. Nope, he just stands there with this chilling look on his face, like, God damn it, I knew this was gonna happen all along. And then it cuts to credits. Honestly, amazing. Amazing. If you haven't seen it, then watch it right now. Incredible acting with Rob Slasher. This created Slasher first, pretty much. And this has really, really good acting in it. Top-notch acting, as a matter of fact. From a bunch of low-paid, newish, and not well-known actors, except for Donald Pleasance. He was a star. And with a small budget, they did a freaking amazing job with this film. Honestly, I would rate it 5 out of 5. Along with the next Halloween movie, which I'll review, which is my all-time favorite, the second one. And, you know, combined with great acting and, you know, something original and fresh, and there's not too much gore, so it's perfect for pretty much everybody. Overall, this is top-notch horror flick. Probably the best horror movie of all time. So I definitely highly recommend it. And tomorrow I will watch the TV cut of Halloween 2. I'll review that. So, thank you all for watching. And coming up next is a NBA 2K15 My Career. Now, to finish off this video, let's just take a look at the epilogue. And I died, so there's no point in continuing.